Hello and welcome to another video in the series Archaeology and Islam. My name is Dan Gibson, and today we want to examine a question that viewers have asked about the pilgrimage and how it would have fit into the Petra landscape. First of all, historical records tell us that the pilgrimage was practiced before Muhammad's time. Abdul Muttalib, Muhammad's grandfather, was responsible for looking after the pilgrims that came to the Holy City. Remember, this would have been in Petra. Now, the early recorders of Islamic history write a great deal of material about the early pilgrimage. Ibn Hisham spends a great deal of time talking about the pilgrimage before Islam. You see, people would come from all over Arabia and come to the Holy City. Hundreds and perhaps thousands of people would come. This was attested to by the graffiti that is written on rocks as people were going to pilgrimage. It was such a popular event that Abraha, the ruler down in Yemen, became jealous and wanted to divert the people to come to Yemen. Why would he do that? Because of money. Most things are about money. Imagine thousands of people coming to your city and spending their money and undertaking commerce there. What kind of commerce? People needed to have places to sleep. People needed to buy food. Some would buy clothing. Others wanted to take home some object to remember their pilgrimage by. For instance, Ibn Hisham tells us that it was popular for people to take small stones from the city home with them after the pilgrimage. Now, this here is a small multicolored stone that I picked up in Petra. And even today, the local people from the Bedouel tribe sell pieces of colored stone to the tourists. Ibn Hisham also tells us that the practice of the pilgrimage would go back in ancient time all the way to Abraham. This included the great and the little pilgrimage. Abraham is said to have instituted honoring the Kaaba and going around it. He also instituted standing on Arafah Mountain and then going down the Muzdalifah, the slippery slope, and sacrificing an animal, and the pilgrim cry. We learn from Ibn Hisham that the great ancient pilgrimage would focus on Arafah, that mountain. And afterwards, there was a rush of people down the slippery slope called Muzdalifah. We'll look at that in a few minutes. We learn from Ibn Hisham that in pagan times, the pilgrimage could not be changed. It was taboo to change it. So it continued on from ancient times all the way up to the time of Muhammad. And Ibn Hisham also tells us that the Quraysh tribe, Muhammad's tribe, had keys to the Kaaba building and also keys to the door on the well of Zamzam. They kept and they handed out war banners, and it was their authority to divide the city into quarters and designate who could live where. Thus they kept the Christians in their quarter and the polytheists in their quarter. It was the Quraysh who gave the order to not cut down trees in the sanctuary area, and who decided many important things, including what was taboo and what was allowed. Ibn Hisham tells us that eventually they added some things that would be financially benefit to themselves. They forbade cheese and the making of sour milk or clarified butter while people were in a state of haram. They could not enter into tents of camel hair to seek shelter from the sun. They had to go into leather tents. Those were made available for a price. They went further and they refused to allow those outside the haram area to bring in food with them. They had to buy food from the market within the haram area. Go around the Kaaba, but they had to have special garments. And they said if you don't have a particular garment, then you had to go around naked. And if they used ordinary clothing, then they would have to throw that clothing away and destroy it before they could leave the haram area. Well, when Muhammad came along, he took control of the pilgrimage after he took control of the holy city, and he put an end to this money-making in the pilgrimage, and he allowed people to bring in food, and he did not require them to purchase special things on the pilgrimage. But some things he made different. Muhammad introduced the idea of a Qibla, a direction to face when praying. He introduced different prayers so that people were questioning them when they saw the Muslims praying and they wondered, what new religion is this? So it's obvious that he made some changes, but the roots of the pilgrimage go far back in history. And over the years, a variety of new or different practices were slowly introduced, but the basic framework of the pilgrimage remained the same. Now, if Petra is the original Mecca, then the ancient pilgrimage first took place in Petra. The question we want to ask is, can we trace out the ancient pilgrimage route in Petra's landscape? To do this, we need a knowledge not only of the ancient Islamic records, but also of the Petra landscape. You see, Petra has no names on places. The names that it used to have on the different locations have all been lost. After Petra was destroyed by earthquakes, it seems zealous people smashed images, erased inscriptions, plastered walls were chipped off, and the memory of the first holy places of Islam have been eradicated. But while the names are gone, the ruined buildings and the general landscape remain. And I believe that the general pattern of the original pilgrimage route is still evident. And it's very similar to the one in Mecca in Saudi Arabia today. First, we know that the people gathered at two water sources outside of the Haram area, where they washed and where they changed into their pilgrim clothing. One early Meccan historian noted that Muslims who wanted to perform pilgrimage would first purify themselves in the neighboring villages of Tanim and Jirana. And today, this is exactly what you find. There are two natural water sources just outside of Petra. One is closer to the Haram area and one is a bit farther away. The farthest one would have been known as Al-Aqsa, or the farther. And so outside of Petra is a spring that flows year-round. The spring is known today as the Moses Spring. Some tour guides like to tell the story about Moses hitting the rock and the water coming out. I doubt that event took place there, but it makes a good story for the tourists. However, what is more probable is that this spring is the Al-Aqsa Spring in Jirana, and that the lower spring would have been called Al-Adna, which means the lower. Today, the lower area is covered with dense bush and grass. The Al-Adna Spring in Tanim was significant because Muhammad's wife, Aisha, would pure herself there. But the Prophet purified himself and prayed in Al-Aqsa, farther out, the place where the water came out in Jirana. Al-Aqsa, the one that is referred in this story, is not the mosque built in Jerusalem. That was built 90 years after the Prophet died. So we have to be careful when we refer to Al-Aqsa because there were two of them, one in Jerusalem and the other one just outside of the Haram area where pilgrims cleanse themselves before entering the holy city. Today, this would match the description of the spring called the Moses Spring in Petra. So, just outside of Petra in Wadi Musa. So this marks the beginning of the pilgrimage route. After this, the pilgrims would make their way down through the winding path towards the Kaaba. It would take them a while to get there. It's a while to walk. And once they got there, they would circle the Kaaba, and then they would go south between the two big mountains of Safa and Marwa, and they would end up spending the night in Mina. It sounds simple, but today this would be a spectacular journey of 7 or 8 kilometers. Today, this journey would take you right down through the center of the heart of the town of Wadi Musa. You would pass then the lower spring, Al-Adna, which is now used to provide water for several fields and orchards. You would walk past this green spot and then go down, and you would pass through the gates into the modern Petra Park. This would then take you along a path, and you would pass the famous Obelix tomb. And then just past that are the great square blocks that mark the entrance of the forbidden area, the Haram boundary. There are 20 of these stones all the way around Petra, so wherever you come to the city, you will be marked, this is the Haram area. Now these pilgrims would continue the journey and go around the bend of the Wadi, and they would enter into the Petra Thania, known today as the Sikh. This path winds its way right through the center of the mountain. Sometimes the sides are over 40 feet tall. As you walk, you would notice alongside of you a small aqueduct carrying water that comes from the Alexa Spring. Eventually, you would catch sight of the very first major monument. No one knows for sure the true name of this building. Today, it's called the Treasury Building, although, personally, I think it was most likely the City Library. One of the requirements for a city to become a metropolis or a mother city was to have a library, but that's for another video. From here, the pilgrims would pass through the street of facades. It had many tombs along the street, and then they would see the theater on the left side as they walked past all the pilgrims streaming into the city. And on the right, they would see the great urn tomb that was up high above them on the wall of the canyon as they passed by. And beyond the urn tomb, they could see the royal tombs. You see, people wanted to be buried in the holy city. That's where they wanted to have their remains put there. And so there are tombs all over the city. Then they would come to the famous Nymphaeum, the greatest of all water spots in Petra, which I suspect is the original Zamzam. But most of it's been damaged and smashed and washed away. And then they would walk down the ancient colonnaded street with the great temples, the public buildings on either side. Pilgrims could visit the temple of their choice. Alat was up there on the right. And Hubal, his temple was there on the left. And in front of Hubal's temple was a small square black structure that held the black rock. It was known as the Kaaba. Here the pilgrims would walk around it, and then they would head south until they went outside the city to an open area near Mina. This is the largest open spot that would have been used for camping for the thousands of pilgrimages. In ancient times, it would have been known as Du al-Halafa, or Halafa. This was area, it's never been excavated, although it was noted in the surveys of Petra all the way back to the 1930s. After spending a night near Mina, the pilgrims would rise, eat, and prepare themselves to visit the great Arafah Mountain. This would take them several kilometers, and they would be going up a steep incline to reach the top. Once they reached the top, they would stand in vigil, known as Waquf in Arabic, the standing and meditating on the vast panoramic view that was spread out before them. This is a photo of a pilgrim standing on a small rock in Mecca in Saudi Arabia called Arafah. But it was a different situation in Petra. Today, the Arafah Mountain near Petra is commonly called Jebel Haroun. It is the tallest mountain, and it is crowned by an ancient mosque. But Muslims would not be alone up there on that mountain. Remember, the whole city was a place of pilgrimage, so there was a place there for pagans. They would worship there. There was also a church built up there for Christians who wanted to worship on that special spot. You see, this was a holy spot for pagans, for Christians, for Jews, and for Muslims. There's something there for everyone. Those who wished could visit the small mosque at the very peak of the mountain for their time of prayer. Some claim that Aaron is buried there, and it may be true, it may not be true. There's no concrete evidence of that is the mountain that he was buried on. Today, the principal focus in Mecca, in Saudi Arabia, is on the plains of Arafah, but this term is not common in ancient literature. Where the name Arafah doesn't have the word plains attached to it, this only descriptor there gives you the idea of a large mountain. Now, the Prophet Muhammad preached on Arafah Mountain. The assumption in Mecca and Saudi Arabia is that he was on the plain below the mountain when he preached, but this is not inferred in the original text. Rather, He was on the mountain when he preached. Now, Jebel Haron, or Arafah in Petra, has a unique feature. Just below the mountain peak, there's a large area, about 250 meters square, with outlying areas around it. This would be an area sufficient for thousands of people to gather in the afternoon and watch the sun descending over the horizon. Those on the pilgrimage would easily have fit into that spot. It's a very large spot. And as I said before, there's a Byzantine church complex there. And it is presumed by people it was built back in the 5th century. And at the top of the mountain is the ancient Muslim shrine. This was what one would expect if this was the location of Arafah. Notice the Quran refers to the pilgrims pouring down from Arafah through a narrow chute. See, the pilgrims would stand and wait all day until evening, and then they would descend the mountain through that what was known as Muzdalifah. It was a slippery slide going down down the mountain down to the bottom. Now, originally, the pagans did this in the dark, but a man by the name of Qusay started the practice of lighting fires for the people, and this way was practiced during the time of Muhammad when there were fires going down the side of the mountain. And some early writers record that the lights from Muzdalifah could be seen for many, many miles away because it's the tallest mountain in the area, and they would light the lights all the way down. And after this, the pilgrims would come down to the camping spot where they would collect some stones, and then they would stay overnight. The total journey of that day was 7 to 8 kilometers. The next day, the crowds would go to Mina. There was a stone pillar in the center of Mina where they would throw their stones at the largest pillar that was there, known as Jamrat al-Kubra. So where is Mina in Petra? It's not so hard to find it. It would be a very large area with a pillar in the middle, and it would have to be close to the camping area, which is got nearby markets. So that description would fit this spot, which has a large open place with several small buildings and pillars, and a pillar standing alone in the center of the raised platform. Well, this site has been known to archaeologists like Gluck and Horsfield and Conway from the early times back many years ago. It just recently received attention since Sarah Parkak and Christopher Tuttle used a drone to scan the area, and they found the area had been cleared and leveled. It was 56 meters by 49 meters. That's similar to a football field. And considerable effort went into making this area level and paving it with large flagstones. Their report states that this area was constructed in the pre-Islamic times, and it seems to have been used for religious purposes, and it's made a lot of attention in the newspapers recently. These are all characteristics of ancient Mina, which was a stopping place for the pilgrims to throw stones at the pillar. After stoning the pillar, the people would head back to the city, back to the Kaaba, and there they would circle around the Kaaba. After this, they would go 7 times between the mountains of Safa and Marwa. Bukhari mentions that the Prophet loved to do this running in the rainwater passage, rather than moving slowly along with the great crowds on the road. So they would return then at the end of the day to the campsite near Mina and stay for the night. They would have traveled a total of 7 to 8 kilometers on that day. The final day of the pilgrimage started at Mina, where the pilgrims would stone all 3 pillars. Then they would return to the Kaaba for the final tawaf, or the circling around of the Kaaba. At this point, most pilgrims would return to Mina for the final dismissal, although some people left directly from the Kaaba area. What is fascinating in all of this is that the pilgrimage fits Petra perfectly. The mountain is there, outside of the great stones that mark the south side of the sacred area. At the top of the mountain, there is archaeological evidence that this area was a pilgrimage site for many centuries, going back long before the time of Islam. The great space of Mina is there, with the base of the pillar that the pilgrims could throw stones at. The Kaaba foundation is there, where the pilgrims could go around the Kaaba. And to the right and left of the valley are the great mountains of Safa and Marwa. Even the two springs for ritual cleaning are in place just outside of the great stones that mark the sacred area. So how did the pilgrimage get changed to Mecca in Saudi Arabia? Well, when the Black Rock was moved to Mecca in Saudi Arabia, the pilgrimage ceased. It was in the middle of the Second Fitna, or Civil War, and the records tell us the pilgrimage stopped during that time. And so the rebels down in Mecca and Saudi Arabia must have decided to hold their own pilgrimage, while the others held their pilgrimage up in Petra. But in Saudi Arabia, they were hard-pressed to come up with suitable locations. So they chose two big rocks to represent Safa and Marwa. Arafah, it was just a small hill that pilgrims would gather on. The cave where the revelation took place was just a slab of stone that had fallen down. And there were no marker stones for the Haram area, none whatsoever, still or not today. And they had to build a pillar for the stoning. Yes, it was a pilgrimage, but it lacked the spectacular setting that was in Petra. There was no thania or souk through which people passed right through the center of the mountain. There was no pagan temples. There were no Christian churches. And there was no spectacular views on the sunset on Mount Arafat. And no dangerous slippery slope coming down Muzdalifa. So when did the pilgrimage to Petra cease? You would expect that years later, some people would remember pilgrimage to Petra and still go there to pray. The truth is, Petra, and especially the top of that great mountain, was the object of pilgrimage for many years. The last pilgrimage to the great mountain in Petra took place in 1985. That's right, 1985. That year, several things happened. First, the area was designated as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And so the government prepared for the arrival of many tourists, not pilgrims, tourists who paid money to get in. The next year, in 1986, a new government department was formed, Department of Fatwas, and they declared that the pilgrimage to Petra was just a local superstition and contrary to Islam, and it was stopped. So now today, people are writing to me and saying that they would like to go on pilgrimage to Petra. They want to perform the original pilgrimage. They want to walk in the steps of the original pilgrimage and where the prophets went and where his companions were. Now, I'm unaware of anyone who's done it yet, and I do not suggest that you try it. There seems to be laws in place against it, specifically against pilgrimage to Petra. You can read more about the archaeology involved by checking out my book, Early Islamic Qiblas. It can be downloaded from the internet for only $15, or you can buy the full-color hardbound book from Amazon. I'm Dan Gibson, and this has been another video in the series, Archaeology and Islam.